Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the last several lectures, we saw how to represent a system of linear equations as a mathematical object called an augmented matrix. When working with an augmented matrix, it is important to keep in mind that the entries which lie to the left of the vertical line are the equation's variable coefficients, and that the entries to the right of the vertical line are the equation's constants. We will therefore refer to the entries on the left as the coefficient entries, and the entries on the right as the constant entries. In the previous lecture, we saw how, through the process of Gaussian elimination, an augmented matrix can be reduced to row echelon form. At that point, to solve the system of equations, we have two choices. As we saw, one choice is to convert the matrix back into equations, which are now simpler and easier to solve using back substitution. Another choice, as we will see in this lecture, is to continue to reduce the augmented matrix through a process called Gauss-Jordan elimination. Gauss-Jordan elimination uses the same elementary row operations as Gaussian elimination. But with Gauss-Jordan elimination, the matrix is simplified to the point that the solutions can be determined directly from the matrix without having to convert it back into equations. Once a matrix has been reduced using Gauss-Jordan elimination, it is said to be in reduced row echelon form. So what exactly is reduced row echelon form? In the previous lecture, we saw that matrices in row echelon form must satisfy three requirements. The first requirement is that the leftmost non-zero entry in each row, called the row's leading entry, must be 1. The entries to the right of a leading entry can have any value, 0 or otherwise. The second requirement is that each row's leading entry must lie to the right of the leading entry in the row above it. And the third requirement is that if there are any rows which contain all zeros, those rows must be positioned last at the bottom of the matrix. Reduced row echelon form includes these same three requirements, but it also includes one additional requirement. In reduced row echelon form, each leading entry must be the only non-zero entry in its column. Therefore, if a column includes a leading entry, all the other entries in that column must be zero. In the matrix example shown here, since every column to the left of the vertical line contains a leading entry, all the coefficient entries must be either zeros or ones, which fall on the main diagonal of the matrix. An augmented matrix in this form always represents a system of equations with a single unique solution. For example, this matrix corresponds to a system of equations with the solution 9, negative 7, 2. This form of augmented matrix always results in a single unique solution since each equation in the system equates one variable to a constant. However, some augmented matrices in reduced row echelon form may have columns to the left of the vertical line which do not include leading entries. A matrix like this is still in reduced row echelon form, since all the leading entries are ones. Each leading entry lies to the right of the leading entry above it. And each leading entry is the only non-zero entry in its column. In this case, some rows will have more than one non-zero coefficient entry, and these non-zero entries may have values other than 1. If all the coefficient entries are not ones which fall on the main diagonal, then the system does not have a single unique solution. However, in this lecture, we will only present systems which have a single solution. So starting with an augmented matrix, we use elementary row operations through Gaussian elimination to reduce the matrix to row echelon form. And then we continue to use elementary row operations through the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination to further reduce the matrix to reduced row echelon form. Since the three elementary row operations, swap, scale, and pivot, change the form of an augmented matrix but not the solutions of the system, both Gaussian elimination and Gauss-Jordan elimination result in systems which are equivalent to the original system of equations. These systems will typically have different graphs than the original system. But since elementary row operations don't affect the solutions of the system, the intersection points of the graphs will be the same. So let's see how Gauss-Jordan elimination transforms a matrix in row echelon form to reduced row echelon form. As we saw in the previous lecture, in the process of Gaussian elimination, we worked from left to right and top to bottom, modifying the entries in each column until the matrix is in row echelon form. With Gauss-Jordan elimination, we continue to modify matrix entries, working from right to left and bottom to top, modifying the entries in each column until the matrix is in reduced row echelon form. In the last lecture, we started with a system of linear equations which we wished to solve and represented this system as an augmented matrix. Then, we used the elementary row operations swap, scale, and pivot to reduce this matrix to row echelon form, assuring that the leading entry of each row was a 1 and that the entries below those leading entries were zeros. To further reduce this matrix to reduced row echelon form, we must now continue to use row operations to change the coefficient entries above those leading entries to zeros. This can be accomplished using only pivot operations. We start with the entry directly above the 1. This entry can be zeroed by using a pivot operation to add negative 2 times row 3 to row 2, replacing row 2. We notate this operation by writing r subscript 2 minus 2 times r subscript 3, followed by an arrow and r subscript 2. Multiplying row 3 by negative 2 and adding that multiple of row 3 to row 2, we replace row 2 with the result. Now that the entry above the 1 in the bottom row is 0, the entry above that must also be changed to 0. We can accomplish this by using another pivot operation to add negative 6 times row 3 to row 1, replacing row 1. We notate this by writing R1 minus 6 times R3, followed by an arrow, and all 1. Multiplying row 3 by negative 6. And adding that multiple of row 3 to row 1. We replace row 1 with the result. Now that all the entries above the 1 in the third column are 0, we move over to the second column, where the entry above the 1 in that column must be changed to 0. Once again, we use a pivot operation, adding negative 4 times row 2 to row 1, replacing row 1. We notate this by writing R1 minus 4 times R2, followed by an arrow and R1. Multiplying row 2 by negative 4. And adding that multiple of row 2 to row 1. We replace row 1 with the result. Now that all the leading entries are 1 and the rest of the coefficient entries are zeros, this matrix is in reduced row echelon form. As we saw earlier in this lecture, a matrix in this form, where the leading entries all fall on the main diagonal, corresponds to a system of equations with a single unique solution, and the system represented by this matrix has the solution 9, negative 7, 2. As we mentioned before, one advantage of reduced row echelon form is that these values can be read directly from the matrix. The process we used in the previous lecture to reduce a matrix to row echelon form is called Gaussian elimination. And the process we used in this lecture to reduce a matrix in row echelon form to reduced row echelon form is called Gauss-Jordan elimination. However, the term Gauss-Jordan elimination can also be used to describe the entire process, using elementary row operations to reduce an augmented matrix in any form to reduced row echelon form. The row echelon form of an augmented matrix is generally not unique. Depending upon the sequence of row operations used, a given matrix can typically be reduced to many different equivalent row echelon forms. In fact, any row echelon form matrix can be transformed to an equivalent row echelon form matrix by adding a multiple of any row to any row above it. For example, we can modify the row echelon form matrix from the beginning of this lecture by adding row 2 to row 1. If we replace row 1 of our matrix with this sum, we will have a different but equivalent matrix, which is also in row echelon form. This matrix and the matrix we just modified are both row echelon form matrices and equivalent to the original matrix. So a row echelon form matrix representation of a given system of linear equations is not unique. Using Gaussian elimination, many different row echelon form matrices can usually be produced from the same matrix, depending upon the sequence of row operations used. On the other hand, a reduced row echelon form matrix representation of a given system is unique. The same reduced row echelon form matrix will always be produced regardless of the sequence of row operations used. In this lecture, we have seen how a system of linear equations can be represented as an augmented matrix, which can be reduced to reduced row echelon form through the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination. If the system of equations has a single unique solution, then that solution can be read directly from the augmented matrix. In the next lecture, we will see what happens to the planes which graphically represent this system during the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination.